So with that, and this time I'll start with the side of the panel. Just a couple of thoughts on Make in India, you know, domestic manufacturing versus the impact on price, and is it going to hurt or benefit India in the long run?
To start with, I have to say that domestic manufacturing is important, and India needs it, because manufacturing is something that will have an impact on the GDP. So manufacturing is definitely required, but you know, you need to balance it properly in terms of how much manufacturing you want to do, when you want to do, and then how you are going to control or regulate the imports into the country. So on the one side, your India requires a lot of energy, and India requires a lot of clean energy. So on one side, you want more energy, and on the other side, you know, you don't have the supply chain or the value chain completely in India, starting from a polysilicon to making a module. So my opinion is that it should be balanced. 70% is really not a number to be thought of today. On one side you are saying 70%, other side you are saying 175 gigawatt or 100 gigawatt. So this is not a right balance. So of course, there needs to be a right balance, and that number needs to be worked out.
Actually, it's very important, Make in India. I think as a country, jobs are very important. What exactly China is doing is creating jobs. It's sustaining itself, the most important thing in India. But unfortunately, when we say, yes, we need to make in India, yes, it creates job, it adds to GDP, it supports our industry, everything. But as an industry, as a solar industry, it combines all together, all stakeholders, developers and the government agencies. It's very important to note that why is that we are not able to be competitive. I think we already have manufacturing in India. Still, we are talking about anti-dumping. I'm not against or for all these duties. The most important is how do we strengthen our industries so that it is very competitive in the global market. It could be in terms of funding or the capital infusion, the cost of capital. I think most important, especially in a manufacturer, focus comes like, where does the cost come from? I think we have got a lot of financiers or financial experts sitting across here. And the second most important is the sort of a legal or regulatory free framework, which is very essential. In India, I do respect, and it has been a great year of our central government last couple of years, but there is still a lot to be done in terms of regulatory framework and red tapeism, which will really enable people to set up their own plants. That's really practically on the ground. I have my inhibitions, like how does that really happen? And the most important thing is create opportunities. I think now there is an EOI for about 20 gigawatt, something like that, where a lot of things have been spoken about backward integration from silicon ingots, wafers, cells. A long-term plan should really be, it will help all of us, I guess, as a country and as an industry.
Thank you. And you know, when you're talking, please also give your opinion on how you feel about funding manufacturing Make in India initiatives within the solar PV segment.
Sure, thank you. Right. So Make in India, I believe, will be successful only with timely and effective interventions from the government, with economic policies which are essentially positive reinforcements to the underlying concept of Make in India. Let's talk about what's going on here on the domestic manufacturing front. It'll only help. So okay, let me break it down into three recent policy moves that I believe will strengthen the economy substantially. Bank recapitalization, we have all heard about it. 2.1 trillion is the amount that is going to be plowed back into the banking system. Now it is an excellent opportunity for companies which want to leverage the Make in India drive and try and use these funds, these lines of funds which are available or going to be available very shortly, and make in India a success. Second, let's talk about GST. May not be very clear as of now, but GST is indeed broadening the indirect tax base of the country. We are seeing early successes in terms of interstate check posts. So GST also will take its time, but will in a way help make in India prosper and achieve the heights that it is supposed to. And finally, the insolvency and bankruptcy code, which no one has kind of touched upon, but that again empowers RBI, for instance, to initiate proceedings. That gives the lenders a lot of confidence, which will percolate into more funding and obviously a better thing for the industry at large.
Thank you. Could you just please, or start from the left side of the panel now. So just very, very quick thoughts, because we'd like to have some amount of discussion after that.
See, I personally... I personally believe that Make in India is the mainstay of our national solar mission. So on one side, when we are targeting 100 gigawatt of power, and another side, we are talking of manufacturing, robust manufacturing base. So this has to go hand in hand. There is no doubt that all these kind of measures which have been recently implemented, like safeguard duty, anti-dumping duty, or maybe the import duty, or maybe the imposition of BIS norms. These all are basically to support the domestic industry itself. And these are very much essential. But from the developer's perspective, or maybe from the DISCOM's perspective, we have to see a balance of both. Maybe because of 70%, which is on a very higher side. So it has to be somewhere around maybe 20 to 30%, so that manufacturing base is also supported. And on the other side, the cost of generation doesn't go up very much. Secondly, the whatever revenues which are being accrued through imposition of these kind of duties, it has to be reinvested into the industry itself, maybe to incentivize the manufacturing, or maybe to incentivize the customer. And secondly, there has to be a rationalization kind of duties and taxation structure. It cannot be that you have a multiple duties and multiple structures. So government has to look from that perspective also.
Okay, thank you so much. Please continue.
My heart goes out to Make in India. You know, I'm all for Make in India. But what exactly do we want to make in India? Everybody is putting their effort into module manufacturing. We have 8 gigawatts of module manufacturing. But as you just said, on the cell side, there is 3 gigawatts. What about wafer? What about inverters? What about structures? Okay, Make in India has to be on a line wherein we make what is lacking, not exactly what we already have. Everybody jumps into modules because it is easy. It's an assembly process, get the machinery, set it up, it's fine. Cell is is tougher, wafer is tougher than cell. So if we want to, you know, go ahead and create a stream in India wherein we will actually support Make in India, we need to focus on what we are actually not making in India right now, like cells, wafers, even silicon. Okay, then it'll be a more impactful thing.
Thank you so much. So again, Amit, very interesting dimension. Are we talking Make in India or are we talking Assemble in India? Sir.
Yep. All right, I believe Make in India, I think, is here now, first of all. And I was, for last 2 days, in touch with MNRE on the subject and also with SECI. I think the roadmap seems to be clear, that they have put a roadmap and the first step has been taken. They've invited a concept note, MNRE that is, on how to go about it, and it addresses all these issues except for the inverters. It still touches upon the whole thing remains, yes, and that's where I have a reservation on MNRE's view, that they have talked about module to cell to wafer to ingot. They have talked about it in a phased manner. The good news is that they have also, to assure the investor, given a roadmap of the business opportunities. And for that, SECI has been inviting the expression of interest from the manufacturers on the basis that this will be the scheme of 30% subsidy. And on the basis of that, how much manufacturing capacities can be expected? So they have invited an EOI,
So the Vikram Solars and Waris and Moser Bears and the Tata Solars have to now rise up and say, hey, I'll do this much of cell and this much of wafer in next 2 years, 3 years. Please allocate me the capacity on the basis of this and go for the domestic content encouragement. And also what capacities I'll make will give me the economy of scale to compete with international prices. In that much, I believe for the first step, I will compliment the authorities that they have cracked the code. Now the next level, which is a tough level, is to be achieved. And having said that, there's a lot of money available to come into India for all these things at a very soft term. Because the whole jigsaw puzzle is being addressed from various angles. ISA is an example where India has taken even a lead over China, because China had to finally become a member. But ISA was the brainchild of Mr. Narendra Modi. And now that seems to be working. So money at a soft concessional rates is here to come. And let's not become myopic. 100 gigawatt may happen in 2022 or 2024. But the way the government is looking at it, it is going to be here, even beyond 2022. So the capacity generation is a need of the hour, and the government is moving in the right direction. And I am sure, not only at module level, but right upstream, as I mentioned in my this thing also, the capacity initiation and generation will happen, and manufacturing entrepreneurship will take up this challenge to come to the levels of expectation.
Thank you, sir. Ashutosh?
So here I'll sort of like to disagree with the, most of the people about talking and make in India, specifically on the module front. And I totally agree with Amit. We've missed the bus on modules. And there's no point, you know, still harping about it that our industry is getting affected and all of that. Now, let's why not focus on things that are not being done by China? For example, what Amit was saying, inverters. For example, what Ritu was saying, O&M. Now, O&M, will you believe that in India as of now, there is no professional company which does O&M of solar power plants? That's an opportunity, and we are a, what we call as a skill-driven country. We have ample amount of skill in terms of labors, manpower, workforce, which can run these operations of businesses in terms of O&M side of things. Now, if you can go back harping about that, we don't have capacity, we need to encourage our module suppliers and all of that. But to be honest, do a 70% import duty as of now, or a safeguard duty as of now, you'll kill the industry by end of it. You want to do an import of safeguard duty, do it in phase manner. Put it 10% this year, going up to 50% in the next 5 years. Let the guys who are making modules get up to speed to cater to the demand, followed by don't kill the guys who are developing these models for you. By end of it, it's somebody's money at stake. So I totally disagree with the way path that the Indian government is following on, that we are still thinking 5 years behind China, that now we are thinking about, okay, let's safeguard ourselves on modules. Have you forgotten about inverters? Have you forgotten about structures? Still today, there are two or three aluminum structure providers in India. Let's talk about that. Let's talk about things which are not being done. Why doesn't India want to become the best O&M supplier companies across the globe? Why do we only want to do modules? And also, parallelly to this, does India have those silicon reserves? About backward integration, China went out shopping, as of today also. If you talk about batteries and storage, China owns most of your magnesium and lithium ion mines across the globe. They went 5 years ahead on this. They are again one step ahead on us in terms of the batteries front also. So let's look at a holistic perspective. Let's not, you know, narrow down on one thing and kill the bird.
Thank you so much.
So I think a lot of perspective has already been given. So I think Make in India is a slogan which will be cutting across all industries. If you look at just solar and over the next 5 years, we typically have five-year plans. So we have these aggressive targets which we are going to be looking at in terms of deployment of solar. And the goal, and to do that with these kind of safeguard duties might not be a very intelligent thing to do, especially if you want to achieve that level of energy security. So the goal of this, these kind of duties is to remove the dumping portion, right? So if developers make a conscious decision to go for the right equipment selection, then naturally the dumping is going to be out of the equation to a good extent. You can get a Longi solar module from China, which is one of the higher quality modules, and you can also get a tier 2 module from China. So what you choose to use in your system is what we are doing it as a conscious decision. And higher capex doesn't necessarily translate to higher LCOE. What we are all concerned about is achieving the lowest LCOE, and how do you do that is by the right technology and equipment selection. And of course, Ashutosh touched upon O&M, which which is super critical. So if we can get all of these ends tied in, then I don't think we should be too much, talking about anti-dumping duty, or, you know, maybe do it in a phased manner. Probably if it needs to be done because, yeah, people have invested in setting up manufacturing capacities, educate them on how to do it the right way across the value chain and do the duties in a phased manner.
Thank you so much. A lot of things that came up from the discussion. In one word, would a company like Tata Cleantech today be willing to lend to solar PV module manufacturers in India today? Just in one word.
Well, it cannot be summarized. Because, you can't paint all of them with the same brush, because there will be module manufacturers with excellent pedigree and promoter parentage. So we cannot say for sure that you should not fund any solar module manufacturers. But as all of you rightly pointed out, they need to up their game. They need to increase their capacity utilization levels, bring in more technology, stop using Chinese technology as much as possible. And in the last year, I guess about 90%, Ritu, was used of the capacity used was Chinese modules. So
yeah,
90, right? So we would like to see that reversing, and whatever can be done from financial.
No, even in an ideal world, I would like to see that, you know. It's not even India's most favored country. It is not a country that we have a great political equation with. But it's just that today they are a superpower in manufacturing across multiple segments. Where they have also gone ahead from India is earlier, about even 10 years ago, China was all about consolidation, cheap electricity, their government subsidizing, and them making mass quantities of products. And then, you know, earlier it was not even very high quality. Then they upped the game, and about as far back as 10, 15 years ago, some of the best quality manufacturing also started coming out of China. And now they have started upping their game. They are investing in R&D, they are investing in innovation, they are investing in design, up there with everyone else in the world, with the Germanys, the Japans, the Americas. We are not doing that across the board in this country. You know, in any sphere, I don't really see Indian manufacturers putting their money out into research. And until we are willing to do that, we are never going to catch up. We've not only missed the boat on module manufacturing, we have missed the boat on storage as well. See how much work China, and when they started. They started 5-10 years ago. Just when their module manufacturing picked up, they started working on storage. They're now going to be working on integration. They're going to be working on the next things. Because you have to think big. Here we are completely relying on each one of us is, you know, almost working like in a personal interest group, right? I will do this, you know, as a developer, if I look very selfishly, impact on DISCOM, government's problem. Okay, if I look at very selfishly, and you know, and I'm so glad that despite being in module manufacturing, you have said that yes, the 70% is too high, because you're not looking at a narrow vested interest. Also, what happens, you know, okay, you've put 70% safeguard duty. Backend kahan se are? Where is the backend coming from? It's still coming from China. Do you think they will not retaliate? Okay, you want to make life miserable for you? I will kill your industry. If they want, they can kill your solar industry. If not from China, where else will you buy? Who else has the capacities to supply you? Who can supply you cells? Who can supply you wafers? Who can supply you ingots? So you need to work with them. And you know, obviously it's great to have Make in India. We need to have Make in India, but make what? And what exactly does this make mean? How sustainable is it? Who is going to bear the cost? The result of whatever percent duties you're putting in. You put in 70%, 50%, 20%, 30%. What does the duty do? It raises the price of the material. What does that do? It raises tariff. So eventually we pay, right? It may be the customer paying, it may be the DISCOM paying, it may be, you know, an individual paying, but that cost goes up. Maybe by 30%, 20%, 50%, given that modules are 50 to 60% of a solar plant cost. So eventually we are paying. So is this the way to go about it? Or should the government actually be incentivizing and subsidizing manufacturers at various, you know, stages of production that the government thinks is important for the country. So obviously my knowledge is nowhere near what MNRE and the think tanks that the government has, they have. But if you want domestic module manufacturing, and if domestic module manufacturing for various reasons is not competitive, don't penalize the rest of the industry. Don't penalize the rest of the value chain. You invest your money directly there. Because one way or the other, you know, whether we go around it from a straightforward manner or, you know, roundabout fashion, we have to end up subsidizing them, right? Because the prices will go up. So this is, you know, and I know we have kind of run out of time. If anybody wants to have, you know, a last thought, and if time permits, maybe we can have two or three questions from the audience.
Thank you very much. Indeed, big debate about this current roadblock this year. The 2017 year, last year, started with a big bang. We saw prices tumbling in Rewa, and people were questioning on the viability, and then immediately we saw tariffs much lower than then, and immediately there was GST of 5%, and the GST dust just not just even settled, and we saw this big debate on manufacturing. And definitely there are various aspects about it. It is not a very, very simple riddle to solve. Make in India, definitely, as an Indian, everybody, all of us wants to see lots and lots of manufacturing happening here. But definitely we have missed the bus to a certain extent, and developing the entire ecosystem, especially at the level of sustaining our national solar mission, definitely it's very, very ambitious. And what we are also probably missing out is that make in India could also turn out to be like make in Vietnam or make in Philippines, because you're talking of anti-dumping duty on Malaysia and China. But what about various players who have manufacturing capacities in Vietnam or Philippines? Or for them, probably it would, like big giants who have 10 gigawatts or so of capacity, for them to move out to any other country and start making. These kind of players also did initiatives of, you know, try to establish their manufacturing bases in India. And definitely there has been challenges, and there have been roadblocks for them to scale it up. So definitely, I hope this dust settles soon, and the industry can be back on track. So with this, I'd like to close this session, and thank you all the distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen. It was a very, very indeed, very, very enlightening, very thoughtful, a very knowledge gaining session for all of us. May I request a big round of applause. Moving on, I'd like to take this privilege of requesting our session chair and moderator, Ma'am Ritu Lal, to present small mementos to all the speakers on the dais, please.